Hi, I'm David Bader. I'm a distinguished professor at the New Jersey Institute of Technology, and I am the director of the Institute for Data Science. I'm very pleased today to introduce our speaker, Bo Shen. And Bo is going to speak today about advanced data analytics for quality assurance of smart additive manufacturing. Bo Shen is an assistant professor new this semester in the Department of Mechanical and Industrial Engineering at the New Jersey Institute of Technology. He received his PhD from Virginia Tech in 2022, earlier this year. He also obtained his bachelor's degree in statistics from the University of Science and Technology of China. His research is at the interface of data science and artificial intelligence and advanced manufacturing. He's interested in developing advanced machine learning methods for improving the quality and productivity of advanced manufacturing.
Thank you so much for the invitation and the warm introduction. So today I'll present advanced data analytics for smart additive manufacturing. I slightly changed the topic I will cover today so that we can focus on more the case study we did in the organizational lab. So my name is Bo Shen. I'm currently assistant professor in the Department of Mechanical and Industrial Engineering at NJIT. This is outline for today's presentation. At first, I'll briefly introduce the research background and the motivation. Next, I will cover three research topics. The topic one is thermal image fusion for melt pool monitoring. And we'll analyze the thermal camera data we captured in the agglomeration lab. Topic two is X-ray video decomposition for melt pool monitoring. This is unsupervised machine learning method. We also use the data from our national lab. And the last topic is automatic melt pool segmentation and the tracking in the X-ray video. This is a supervised version to solve the problem in topic two. And in the end, I will talk about summaries and the feature work. Actually, the manufacturing has evolved significantly over the year. A lot of this has to do with the technology. This figure here, the y-axis is a US industry production index, and the x-axis is the time domain. So during this time period, we observed four industrial revolutions. The first industrial revolution began in the 18th century. It's about steam power and the mechanization of the production. The second industrial revolution is about the discovery of the electricity and the assembly line. So we are our way to the massive production. The third industrial revolution begins in the 20th century. It's about the partial automation. We have robot arm on the assembly line to help us to do some operations. Now we are on the stage of fourth industrial revolution. We can also call it Industry 4.0. And smart manufacturing is one of the most important components in Industry 4.0. We are trying to build smart machine. Those machines are connected with sensors. We have robot arm. We have additive manufacturing machine. And they also have a wireless connection capability so that different machines can talk with each other. And once we get the data, we can feed the data into the machine learning AI model so that the machine itself can make decisions and to improve the quality and the reliability. So when we mention about manufacturing, nowadays, additive manufacturing is one of the hottest topics. So let me first introduce what is additive manufacturing. Additive manufacturing are technologies that build 3D objects by adding layer by layer of material. This image you see here is a bioprinting procedure. We will use the hydrogel as a material. And we can also have different material like metal powder, polymer, et cetera. Additive manufacturing has many advantages. The first one will be small personalized production. So nowadays you can easily purchase a 3D printer from Amazon. It takes less than $200. For a polymer machine. However, for a big scale metal end machine, it may cost you $1 million. additive manufacturing can also support AI-driven design method, and it can also print very complex structure. Due to those advantages, additive manufacturing has many novel applications. For example, GE has 3D printing jet engine. And in biomedic and healthcare applications, they also have bioprinted organs. You can use the printer to print the scaffold to support the cell growth. And for personal use, we can have the 3D printing respirator for the personal protection equipment. Smart additive manufacturing is the integration of additive manufacturing, sensing, simulation, and data analytics, AI. So starting from the additive manufacturing process, those are the machine and the equipment in our lab or in the organizational lab. The left two images are the equipment in the lab at Virginia Tech. We have the fused filament fabrication machine, which is one of the most popular polymer M-based machine. The bottom one is the metal M machine we built from scratch. Basically, this room was empty 2 years ago, and we assembling everything together by ourselves. We have laser, we have XR camera, we have IR camera, we also have hot bed controller, and we also have laser power controller. Today, our focus will be the metal M platform in organizational lab, because they have a very fancy X-ray facilities to capture very high-speed X-ray data. So this is from the process point of view. How can we get the information? We can install sensors or run the simulation. This requires a lot of hardware and software. And in my research, we have used IR camera, 3D scanner, digital image correlation, and a microscope. We have also used Net5 Flow 3D, so simulation software to simulate the additive manufacturing process. The step of sensing and the simulation will provide us a lot of data for the analytics and artificial intelligence. We have analysis X-ray image, thermal image, microscope image is to use monitor the surface quality. We also have the point cloud to characterize the surface roughness. And we also have the melt pool from Flow 3D and the mechanical stress from Autodesk. So there are a lot of data produced in manufacturing, and the manufacturing actually is a big component in the US economy. It actually contributes more than 12% in the US economy. And this is the data for the 2018 from the DOE, Advanced Manufacturing Office. And I believe this number is keeping increasing even though because of COVID. And you can see many big companies, Google, Amazon, GE, and Merck. Those are all the big contributors in the manufacturing. Actually, manufacturing can produce much more data compared to other application domains like commercial, media, banking, retailer, healthcare. However, in the literature, only less than 25% of data is currently utilized. So it's still an underdevelopment area, need a lot of investigation and research. So our focus today is laser powder bed fusion, which is one of the most popular metal additive manufacturing process. In laser powder bed fusion, a high power laser melts thin layers of the powder to create a part. This image is from NIST, and so smooth surface is actually the powder. The spark you see here is created by the laser. Once the laser scans through the powder, those powder will melt and then solidificate. And those surface after solidification. And in the next layer, all the surface will be covered by the powder and we'll scan the laser again. And we did our experiment in the advanced photon source in organization lab, because it can provide X-ray beams for the research. This is the overview of the organization lab, and we did some experiment here. And the round circle here is actually the particle accelerator. And I think that's one of the only a few facility can produce that high speed, high density X-ray data in the United States. Now let's talk about our equipment layout, we have the laser on the top and it will shoot a laser to the surface. And this is the printing chamber. We have thermal camera installed to real-time monitoring the printing process. We also have the high-speed X-ray imaging systems to monitor the printing process. So what we are trying to study here, well, we are interested in the melt pool. When we apply a laser to the metal powder, the area where the powder melts to the liquid is called melt pool. And the melt pool history is a very crucial problem for material scientists because it can be utilized to characterize the thermal gradient, solid liquid boundary velocity, porosity, etc. The left image shows one frame of the thermal image. We install thermal image on the top of the printing surface. So we can only observe the top surface information about melt pool. And depth information about the melt pool can only be obtained by the X-ray data. This is the one frame of the X-ray data. The red dashed line here is actually the liquid gas boundary, and the blue dashed line is actually the solid liquid boundary, which is the melt pool of our interest. So now let's talk about our first topic, thermal image fusion for the melt pool monitoring. And we'll go details to introduce our experiment setup. We first install a small thermal camera, microwave zone L1, inside of chamber because this thermal camera is small. Since the distance between the pad and the camera is very short, so we can produce high spatial but a low temporal resolution. And this bigger thermal camera is called TAPS M3K. It is so big and bulky, so we can only install it outside of chamber. As a result, it can provide high temporal but low spatial resolution image. So to summarize, the TAPS M3K, the big thermal camera, can provide us 20 kHz temporal resolution and a 30 micron spatial resolution. The small thermal camera can provide us 1 kHz temporal resolution and 3.6 micron spatial resolution. So these two thermal cameras can provide us complementary in spatial temporal domain for the thermal image videos. However, to do the melt pool monitoring, we need a very high temporal resolution, at least 20 kHz, since the dwell time of the laser is very short. We also need a very high spatial resolution, around 3 micron per pixel, for detailed thermal gradient calculation. And we did the literature reviews in the current market. We cannot find such a high spatial, high temporal resolution thermal camera. So since we have those two thermal data, so we need to build an algorithm to integrate the two image streams to achieve both high spatial and high temporal resolutions for our current solution. And we are kind of trying to do super resolution in both temporal and spatial domain. Our research methodology is based on tensor completion. So I will first introduce what is the concept of tensor. A tensor is high dimensional extension of matrix. For example, a vector is order one tensor because it only has one direction. A matrix is order two tensor. We have x, y, two direction. A cube is the third order tensor. We have x, y, z, three direction. And the tensor completion is a task to estimating missing values in the tensor. In the left image, we only have partially observed elements. There are a lot of missing values. And then we can apply tensor completion method to fill out all those missing elements to obtain the complete tensor. Our thermal image streams are tensors, and we can also formulate our super resolution problem as a tensor completion. The top image stream is the high temporal stream from the big thermal camera. The bottom one is the high spatial but low temporal resolution image streams, which is from the small thermal camera. We can align those thermal image along the time domain, and then we can enlarge those low spatial resolution image to have the same size as the high spatial one, but with missing pixels in between. Then this big thermal image streams has the high temporal, high spatial resolution, but with missing pixels. And we can apply tensor completion to fill out all the missing values. Then it becomes the complete image streams. So the mapping from the low spatial resolution image to the high spatial one can be done by the forward mapping, which follows this mathematical rule. Basically, each pixel in the low spatial resolution image will be picked into the grid of the high spatial one. For example, the first row and eighth columns in the low spatial resolution image will be put into the second row and the 21st columns in the high spatial one based on this mathematical rule. So now I would like to talk about our model formulations. And our proposed method is called smooth and sparse tensor completion, because in the literature, tensor completion is not good at estimating sharp change. And in our case, for our thermal image, we have the sharp change caused by the laser. And by using the concept of smooth and sparse decomposition, this is our proposed formulation. We first have the smooth tensor, which is decomposed by the rank R CP decomposition. R here is the smooth rank. We also have the sparse rank, which is modeled by the rank M CP decomposition. M here is the sparse rank. We can also decompose our data into the smooth tensor and the sparse tensor and the additional error terms. And these error terms will be used to calculate the model fitting error in the first term of the objective function. The second term of the objective function is about the smooth regularization term, which is used to enforce the smoothness of the smooth tensor. The third term in the objective function is the sparse regularization terms. We use this term to enforce the sparsity of the z-sparse. So this is a highly non-convex and non-smooth normalization problems. Later on, we'll introduce an algorithm to solve this problem. So now the question is, why can we trust these two regularization terms to enforce the smoothness and the sparsity of tensors? Because they are in the vector space. So lemma one shows that the two regularization terms in this formulation are actually the upper bound for the smoothness and the sparsity measurement on the tensors, which can be represented by these three inequalities. So the takeaway is, based on this lemma, we can trust our formulation to enforce the smoothness and the sparsity of tensor from the vector space. As I mentioned before, for the case of non-smooth and sparse rank, our optimization problem is a highly non-convex and non-smooth optimization problem. We propose alternative minimization algorithms to solve the problem. Basically, we are alternative between two steps. In the first step, we will fix all the sparse component and we will try to solve the smooth optimization problem. And we'll update all the smooth component. In the second step, based on the updated smooth component, we'll solve the sparse local optimization problem to obtain updated smooth sparse components. And we'll repeat this procedure again and again until we reach the convergence. We also announce the algorithm convergence for our proposed algorithm. And cell the one says that the objective function value output by the algorithm has a momental decreasing properties, and actually is a strict momental decreasing properties. The right-hand side of the inequality is used to characterize the CP singular values difference between two iterations. And the next step, we can also obtain the CP singular value convergence for the CP decomposition. CP singular values are corresponding to the singular value in the metric case. They are important values to track the convergence. So now that to introduce our rank estimation algorithms, because in reality, we never know what is the true rank for smooth and sparse component. Therefore, we try to minimize the total rank for predefined fitting error. And this is our objective function, which is the summation of the smooth and sparse rank. The red part in the constraint is our predefined fitting error so that we can guarantee have good performance in the model fitting. The blue part in the constraint is how we decompose our model into the smooth and the sparse component in the tensor completion setting. To solve this optimization problem, the basic idea is that if the current smooth and the sparse rank cannot achieve the predefined fitting error, we'll increase the rank by one. Essentially, it's a heuristic approach. And this is our rank estimation algorithm. And from line 5 to line 10 is how we increase smooth rank by 1. Every time when the algorithm detects if the current rank is not efficient to decrease, the model fitting error will increase smooth rank by 1. And the line 14 to 19 is how we increase the sparse rank by 1. So I will skip the detail for this algorithm and talk about our case studies. So we first did one numerical simulation to verify whether our proposed algorithm can recover the ground truth of smooth and sparse components. And we first simulate the smooth component by Gaussian random field. And we also use ellipse ring to simulate sparse component. So by adding these two components together, we can see our simulated image in the left figure. This yellow ellipse ring is our simulated sparse component. And then to apply tensor completion, we randomly select 20% of missing pixels in the figure B as our input data. And we try to apply tensor completions to fill out all those missing values. So let's look at our visualization results. So the first column is the ground truth of smooth and sparse component. This is our predicted smooth component, which is almost the same thing as the ground truth. And we can observe very small scale of the smooth error. This is our predicted sparse component, and it can capture the ellipse ring in terms of global structure. We have some small errors in the error map because we can never observe those values in the, because those are missing values in the models. We also did one case study by using the setup in my lab. And we are trying to study the Quinlan process, a heated polymer M part. And this is our experiment setting. We have two thermal cameras, and this one is closer, and this one is far away. So the closer one can produce a high resolution image. The far away one can produce a low resolution. As we can see, these two thermal cameras are installed at different angles. So the first thing we do is apply homography to map the two cameras into one angle. And in the end, we obtain 21 low spatial resolution image and the 5 high spatial one. And this is our comparison result. We first apply Bayesian optimization to all the benchmark methods and our proposed algorithms for parameter tuning. Since we only have 5 high spatial resolution image, we randomly select 4, 3, 2, 1 high spatial resolution images as testing data. For example, in scenario 1, we will randomly select 4 high spatial resolution image as leave out testing data for the evaluation purpose. In scenario 2, we will randomly select 3 high spatial resolution image as leave out testing data. In terms of criteria, we compare with relative standard error. A smaller value of ISC represents a better performance. We also have the PSNR, which represents peak signal to noisy ratio. A higher value of PSNR represents a better performance. And from this table, we also compare with 5 state-of-the-art tensor completion method. So from this table, our proposed algorithm has the best prediction accuracy in terms of runtime. Even though our proposed algorithm is not the most efficient one, it can achieve the same magnitude of the most efficient algorithms in terms of computational time. And we also have the visualization result. This figure is original high spatial resolution image, and the figure B is our predicted one. And you can see their features are very close to each other. And since our algorithm can also decompose the predicted image into the smooth and the sparse component, and this is the smooth component capture the smooth background, we also have the sparse component, which actually captures the hot spot designed in our experiments. We apply local heat treatments in these locations to create a sharp change. So basically, our algorithm can well capture the hot spot and can separate the signals. At the same time, it can also recover the original image. So now I'd like to talk about the second topic, X-ray video decomposition for melt pool monitoring. And we use melt pool to monitor depth information about the melt pool. The only way to obtain depth information is through the X-ray. And this, for the same experiment setup, we also have the X-ray sensing capability. At first, X-ray beam will go through a chamber and arrive at X-ray detector. And our high-speed X-ray camera will capture all the X-ray data. So this is a very high-speed camera. Within 1 second, we can receive 70,000 of images. And now let's look at the part view, how we apply the laser and X-ray. The laser is applied on the top surface, and X-ray goes through the side surface. And this is our specimen for the printing. So now let's look at our X-ray data. We are interested in the melt pool boundary, which is a solid liquid boundary. The laser is moving from the left to the right. And those small bubbles are actually porosity defects in the specimen itself. So if we stop in the middle, the boundary you see here is actually the gas liquid boundary. This boundary is very clear because liquid, gas, their density are very different. The solid liquid boundary is very hard to detect in this X-ray data because their density are very close to each other. So we have to apply some pre-processing techniques to enhance the boundary. And we also have our material scientist collaborators to suggest us how to do it. And this is a pre-processed result. Even though the image becomes very noisy, we can clearly see the meltable boundary here. However, now the research question is, how can we remove the noise to better visualize the meltable geometry? So in the literature, we have robust PCA. We are trying to decompose the matrix of corrupt observations into the underlying low rank matrix and the sparse error matrix. The sparse error matrix is trying to capture the sparse noise. And later on, people also extend the matrix to tensor. They propose robust tensor PCA, and they are trying to decompose a tensor into an underlying low rank tensor. This is a clean data. And the sparse error tensor, it captures the noise. However, for our process X-ray data, we have the static background, we have the moving melt pool, and we also have some random noise. We can apply robust PCA, robust tensor PCA. They can remove the noise, but they cannot separate the melt pool from the background. However, the melt pool is our research interest. So we have to propose our own decomposition strategy for our noisy X-ray video. And we try to decompose our noisy X-ray video into the low-rank tensor, which captures the static background, a smooth tensor, which captures the melt pool, because the melt pool is moving smoothly along the spatial temporal domain. And we also have the sparse tensor to capture the noise. To model the low rank tensor, we use the target decomposition. And this is a visualization for the target decomposition. Target decomposition decomposes a tensor into a core tensor and a set of factor matrix. So it's similar to SVD in the matrix case. In SVD, we only have an organ matrix and we have two factor matrix. So it's a high dimensional extension of the SVD. And to model the smooth tensor, we assume the tensor has a special temporal continuity. And to describe the special temporal continuity, we also define three different operations along the special temporal domain. This is a horizontal direction difference, and this is the definition for the vertical difference, and this is the difference along the temporal domain. These operators can actually simplify it into a matrix form, and based on the matrix form, we can also define the anisotropy total variation norm, which can be characterized by the matrix and the vectorized version of the tensor here. And similarly, we can also define the isotropic total variation form of the tensor. The sparse tensor can be enforced by the L1 norm, and then we can have our proposed formulation, which is a constrained, non-convex, non-smooth optimization, and we use L1 norm to capture the sparsity. The red part here is for the smooth component. We have the anisotropy norm here. And this part is how we decompose our tensor into a low rank tensor, smooth tensor, and a sparse tensor. And this is how we do the target decomposition. And to solve this optimization problem, and I propose efficient algorithms based on ADMM. And this is the algorithm to solve our proposed formulation. And I will skip the details, but we also figure out hyperparameter settings that can be applied to many data sets, and it works well universally among different data sets. Now let's look at our applications in computer vision. Even though our proposed method is motivated from additive manufacturing, it has broad applications in many other domains like computer vision and healthcare. This is a video in a shopping mall, and people are walking around, and we also have some snow noise. So our proposed method can actually capture the static background, which is a background of the shopping mall. And our method also can capture the people walking, because people is walking smoothly in the video frames. And we also have the snow noise captured by the sparse tensor. And then let's look at the additive manufacturing studies. This is our pre-processed noisy X-ray video. In our background, we can barely see any change. And actually, our method can detect those small bubbles, which is not visible in the noisy X-ray data. And in our foreground, the X-ray video becomes more clear, and the multiple boundary is more visible to our human being. This gives us a better opportunities for our human expert to outline the multiple boundary with high accuracy. So this result is good, but it's not perfect yet, because our X-ray video has very high frequency. So within 1 second, we need to analyze 17,000 images. It's almost impossible for a human being to manually label the multiple. So that's why I propose automatic multiple segmentation and tracking in X-ray video. And for the same setup, the question now is, how can we automatically extract the multiple mask for the analysis purpose? So the multiple dynamics can be characterized by segment out the multiple boundary. So therefore, we need a fast, accurate, automatic segmentation method to improve the workflow efficiency for the material science discovery for additive manufacturing. There are several challenges in multiple automatic segmentation. The first thing is high level of noise, which is caused by the pre-processing. But we have to do the pre-processing to enhance boundary. The second one is the change in illumination, because when we change the experiment setting, the X-ray video will look different. And the last one is lack of shark image boundary. This is caused by the low density difference between the liquid and the solid phase. However, a recent advance in computer vision and potential application in self-driving cars and augmented realities, there are also a lot of open source annotated data sets give the rise of the video object segmentation. And in this work, we are trying to apply the video object segmentation for multiple segmentation. And in the current literature, there are several machine learning methods involved with multiple. So we have the Institute Multiple Machine Learning Classifier on the visible light high-speed camera images. And we also have the multiple boundary extraction and its width prediction from the IR camera. We also have the laser power prediction of the multiple images on the high-speed opto camera. And we also have deep learning-based multiple classification method to analyze the multiple sites on the high-speed camera. And we also have the digital image processing on the X-ray image. Deep learning-based method for multiple segmentation has not been investigated in the laser powder bed fusion for X-ray images. And our proposed method here is based on semantic segmentation, which can be thought as a pixel-wise classification. It is classification, localization, and boundary detection altogether. So for the neural network for classification, it requires the input transformation environment. Basically, when you rotate the image, then input to the neural network, it will have the same output. It will classify the image as a cat, no matter how you rotate the image. For the object detection, when you rotate the image, the output will be different. That requires the neural network to be transformation sensitive. So they really have different requirements for the neural network, actually contradictory requirements for the neural network, which make it a very difficult task to training. In the literature, we can characterize the approach into two categories. The first one is end-to-end deep neural network. And under this branch, we have the unsupervised semantic segmentation and the semi-supervised segmentation. So unsupervised, semi-supervised here is in the test phase. So in the testing, we can also input one frame of the reference mask to the prediction model. This is called semi-supervised segmentation. We also have non-end-to-end trainable neural network. We do two step procedure. In the first step, we decouple the neural networks into the localization and the classification. So we first input the image to the neural network. It can extract the region. And then we will localize, based on the localized information, we do the classification, saying the label of different objects. In the end, we'll do the boundary processing to get a detailed feature for the boundary. So our proposed method is based on reference-guided mask propagation, RGMP for short, and I will decompose. I will break down the model structure into details. So we have two input streams. The bottom input streams is the reference frame and the reference mask. The top one is the target frame and the previous frame's mask. And then these two encoders feature will be combined together and feed into the global convolutional block. And then the feature will go through the three refined modules and to our final output. So our proposed RGMP with attention, we try to apply the attention modules into the neural network structure. Attention is motivated from human being. When we look at a cat or a dog, we know where to look to make a decision saying it's a dog or a cat. So attention will basically tell you which feature to look at, which part of the image to look at to make the effective decision. And we basically have the same structure, and the low image streams, the low network streams take the first frame and the mask as the input, and the upper one takes the current frame and the previous predict mask as the input. So before we combine the feature, we use a call attention module. We try to use a call attention module to better characterize the temporal correlation of the multiple video because they have high temporal and high spatial resolution, high temporal and high spatial correlation. And then those features will be combined together and fit into the global convolutional block. And then we also replace the attention module by the refined module by the attention module, and this is our final output for the model. Now let's look at our data set. The X-ray data are collected in the APS organization lab. An X-ray beam is shooting on the top, and we use the titanium 64 as the material. We only trained our model on the spot melt videos and test the models on both spot melt and the line scan videos. Spot melt, we basically apply the laser and we will not move the laser during the printing. For the line scan, we will move the laser. So these are two different printing settings. And in our training, we only have the spot melt and we use the line scan for the testing to evaluate generalization ability of our deep learning models. And this is step how we do the model prediction for the data prediction for the new data. We first apply divide by the first frame for the, all the video data, and then we do the frame subtraction, we do the normalization, histogram equalization, and we also apply the field detection.
He did tell me he wanted to come here to take a nap. So, I saw him in the lab, and he's like, I'm going to take a nap at your place. And I was like,
This is our raw video input, and this is our process video. So next step will be annotate the first frame of the video data set. We manually outline the boundary and the input to the we input both data into the multiple predictor for video segmentation. And we also have the visualization results. The first frame, the first row is about our original input, and we plot them along the time domain. The first one is the ground truth, and the third row is about the model without core attention. The fourth one is the model without attention block. The last one is our proposed method. So our proposed method can exactly match with the ground truth, and the model without core attention performs bad. And this verifies the core attention is very important for us to improve the model performance, since our data has very high spatial and temporal correlation, and the core attention can capture the spatial temporal correlation. And we also have the numerical performance. We evaluate the IOU and the DICE index. Those are very popular criteria in the in video segmentation, in image segmentation. So our proposed model can achieve the highest IOU and the DICE. And we also have the frames per second. And because we have both core attention and attention blocks, our computation time is a little bit more compared to other methods. And we also have the visualization result over the length scale video sequence. The first one is noisy X-ray data. And then we have the ground truth for the corresponding X-ray data. And our proposed model can actually predict the line scan also very well. Now I would like to show the video result, because previously we only plot a few frames for the video segmentation result. So our proposed method, the shadow area is our predicted mask. It can exactly catch the multiple boundary. So once we have the multiple boundary, we can calculate the boundary velocity based on the multiple. And I also developed a tool to automatically calculate the boundary velocity from the multiple mask. So together with the thermal gradient we studied in the first topic, we can use the boundary velocity thermal gradient to predict the microstructure, which is very important properties for the material scientist. And we also have the solidification rate for the multiple to use the microstructure prediction. The left one is calculated from the ground truth. The right one is calculated from our predicted mask. And numerically, we can achieve around 10% of errors. And from visualization, we can see their feature can almost match with each other. This result shows that our predicted multiple boundary from our method can achieve human level of accuracy for multiple prediction. Now that to summarize my presentation, so in smart editing manufacturing, the topic one, we propose a smooth and sparse tensor completion for super resolution. In topic two, we propose a smooth, sparse, robust tensor decomposition for the X-ray data. It is unsupervised approach. And the last topics, we propose a deep learning-based model for automatic multiple segmentation in the X-ray data. It is a supervised deep learning approach. In the future, I would like to continue the research in smart additive manufacturing. We have the polymer M process, metal M process, and in maker space, they have both machines available. And we can install sensors from simulation to obtain data. And my main contributions will be the analytics part. And I do machine learning, also do statistics and optimization. So I would also like to emphasize my research expertise. So I do optimization. Most machine learning problems can actually be formatted as optimization. And I propose new optimization algorithms to obtain algorithm convergence. And I also do statistics. We propose new statistical models for high dimensional data. And of course, I do high dimensional sensor data analytics because in real world, data are usually in high dimensional space, such as image, videos, gene. And I'm very interested in the small sample size problems in the high dimensional case. And I'm interested in some sparse problem to add sparsity in the statistical models. Thank you so much for your attention. And those are the papers I covered today. And I also have Twitter and LinkedIn. Please feel free to add me as a friend and we can have a chat.
Oh, thank you very much for this wonderful talk. And I'd like to encourage anyone who has a question to please either put it in the chat or unmute or raise your hand. There was one small question that came in during your talk when you were showing the case studies with high spatial resolution images. And the question was, why did you use exactly 5 high spatial resolution images for that case study?
Sure. So our motivation says we have one image stream has high spatial but low temporal, and the other one has high temporal but low spatial. So we cannot utilize the whole 5 high spatial resolution image streams for the training purpose because we don't have the testing data. So we have randomly select, for example, 4 high spatial resolution image, and the remaining one will be used for testing purpose. That's why we cannot use all the 5 high spatial resolution image for the training.
Thank you.
Because we don't have enough testing data.
That makes sense. So let me see, are there any other questions from our audience? Either put your question in the chat or raise your hand or unmute. And while waiting for questions, maybe I could ask you, because this is a very interesting data science talk for industrial and systems engineering, are there other places where you see data science as being very instrumental in research areas within industrial engineering?
Yes, definitely. There are many domains, like in battery. I think people are also doing some battery studies in ISE. They are trying to the residue of life. They're trying to predict the end of the life for the battery. Uh-huh. Also, some people in rockets doing some energy systems, some wind energy system, wind farm energy system data analytics. So we basically do data analytics in many industry domains. I also did some studies for the vehicle data for the Ford companies. We also do many industry corporations as well.
I see that you have a lot of data coming from, for instance, X-ray imagery and other data sources. Are any of the data sources large or give you challenges for doing the computation?
Yeah, that's so. Yeah, actually, the data we have here is not that large because we spend there like 1 week in organization lab. We try to fully utilize the equipment because their machine schedule is very tight. So they squeeze out 1 week for us to do the experiment, and that's all the data we collected in organization lab. And those data is not that big. And in our lab, we have 4 GPU to run the code. And the 4 GPU is like, we only train the data like half days gets the results. So right now computational, it's not a big issue, uh-huh. But if we run the experiment very long, so we run the experiment only in milliseconds here. But if we run seconds, remember the X-ray image systems, it's very high frequency. It's about 70K hertz. This can generate a massive amount of data. So at that stage, I believe computation will be a bigger burden for the machine learning.
Thank you. There's a question that came in from Nathan Blackman. Does the melt pool boundary detection boundary also depend on the material used?
Great question. Actually, that's a great question. So here, we only test on titanium 64 in this department. And we also have collaborators from Oak Ridge National Labs. They also shared X-ray data to us, which used another different material. So our model trained only on titanium 64. And when we do the prediction, we can also have a good performance in another material. So our model, the prediction is not depends on the material. That's one of the biggest advantage of our method compared to other method.
So Argonne National Labs is actually one of the leading labs in the world for doing exascale supercomputing and with some of the most capable systems on the planet. Have you thought about if you had access to that capability, a problem that you would love to solve on it?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, to do the experiments there, we also need to write a proposal and they need to agree to let us use the machine to use their supercomputer properly. And definitely, like for the big data case, I would definitely try their facility to see how it works.
Thank you. So any last questions from anyone here in the audience? If not, I'd like to thank you again for giving this great data science seminar and welcome to the New Jersey Institute of Technology. We look forward to following your career. And again, thank you again for this very nice talk.
Thank you.